great to see all of you. And first of all, a shout out to the men's Bible study. Thank you for putting on the pancake breakfast. We really enjoyed it. Terrific job. And while I'm throwing shout outs, not only yesterday did we have our food distribution that we do on the third Saturday of every month, but we also had our hula hoedown, and we hoed down a lot of weeds. So it's a good start to getting our property shaped up, and thank you to all the people who showed up for both of those things, the food distribution and the property work day. As Coolwater, we believe in doing things together and being a church in action, which is really what it's all about. But to be prepared to be at our best, to be Christians out in the world, one of the things that helps us along life's way is to gather for worship and to gather to sing, to pray, to praise. And so welcome to worship this day, whether you are here or whether you are joining us online. And we're going to get into our worship now as Dale and the Dynamite Band lead us.
Good morning, everybody. That pancake breakfast was good. Pancakes and eggs, coffee, and to top it off, even a donut to dunk in the coffee. So we're good to go. So please stand and join us if you can. And before we get started, we have a beautiful new member up here, and I'll let Jen introduce her.
This is Sydney Bernice LeDuc, and she is joining us today for all of the songs. So we're very happy to have her.
Very happy to have her. She's 9 years old, you know. Technical difficulty. If we had a bass player, we could blame it on the bass player. So, you are worthy. Okay. Yeah. We'll start right on it. One, two, three, four. I will worship. worship.
I will worship.
All of my heart.
All of my heart.
I will praise you.
I will praise you.
All of my strength.
All of my strength.
I will seek you.
I will seek you.
All of my days.
All of my days.
I will follow.
Gracious God, we give you thanks as we gather to be together, to lift up our hearts in praise, to be strengthened by being here and by being with one another. And so we offer you our worship and pray that you would enter our hearts and touch us as each of us have need. It's in Jesus' name that we lift up this worship and one another. Amen. So take a moment, say hello to one another as we greet each other. Good morning. Okay, good morning. Welcome everybody again to worship. And thanks once again to the men for the great breakfast and to all those who showed up yesterday for the food distribution and the property work day. I hope you noticed as you came up how different it looked this morning than last Sunday when we were here. A lot of the weeds are not there anymore. It looks a lot better. Thank you for all that work. So I'm going to ask, before we get to prayers and prayer concerns, anything else to lift up this morning? Yes, ma'am, I know there is.
Lots of fun, and the four little girls, and the baby was confident. So we talked about
Thank you, Jen, for heading that up and doing such a terrific job. Anything else to lift up joys? I know in prayer concerns, we continue to lift up Chris Bonta, who is making good progress. So, Chris, if you're there, we wish you well, and we are so glad that you're making good progress. Also, we continue to lift up Karen, because I have a feeling you're listening, our secretary, our administrative assistant. Karen Blue is recovering from a surgery. So, Karen, we hope you're doing well, and we look forward to you being back. I know that the Huggins grandson, Adam, is having surgery tomorrow morning on his elbow. He fell and fractured. It didn't appear to be fractured, none of the pain, the things that are giveaway signs, but when they finally did a good x-ray of it, lo and behold, it was fractured. And so they are going to do that surgery tomorrow morning. And they're going to put a plate in. Okay. Anything else to lift up? People of Puerto Rico, Hurricane Fiona. All right, so we lift up the people of Puerto Rico as they face that hurricane, and unfortunately, all the things that we know hurricanes can bring. Anything else? And may we go to our Lord in prayer, and let us begin with a few moments of our own silent prayers. Lord of all, you come to us this day and in this hour, bringing hope and comfort, full and alert, and at other times we may be careless, inattentive. Sometimes we are unprepared and unaware. We have wasted precious gifts of minutes and hours and days. We have been distracted by the insignificant. We have fretted and worried away the hours. And we have put off important tasks before us, always believing there would be more time. And so we pray, gracious God, that you would forgive our foolishness and touch us in our innermost heart, our innermost being once again, and challenge us from our comfortable routines and attitudes. Give us hope in the midst of all those things that would depress us and drag us down or drag us away from the path that you set before us. And fill us with renewed purpose when we are weighted down with despair, with disillusionment. Lift us up. Help us to look for Christ's leading and Christ coming among us in the everyday. Help us to see your light in the midst of the darkness around us. Help us to lift the burdens of our neighbors, for that is one of the tasks that you have given us as followers of Christ, to bear one another's burdens, and help us to do what we can to replace hatred with love, self-centeredness with sharing, and prospects of war and rumors of war and wars in the world with efforts for peace. In all the times of our lives, we stand together as your people, to give comfort to one another, and to lift up our hope that we share in Christ. Be with us in our everyday. Help us to be watchful for the opportunities that you place before us. Keep us alert and prepared so that we do not miss the many surprises you have in store for each of us. For we are always being shaped and molded each new day. So keep us ever ready to see your light around us and to trust in your grace and to be vessels of your everlasting love. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Our scripture today is from James chapter 1, verses 17 to 27, and I'll be reading from the New International Version. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. He chose to us birth through the word of truth, that we might be a kind of first fruits of all he created. My dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry, because human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires. Therefore, get rid of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like someone who looks at his face in the mirror and after looking at himself goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But whoever looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues in it, not forgetting what they have heard, but doing it, They will be blessed in what they do. Those who consider themselves religious and yet do not keep a tight rein on their tongues deceive themselves, and their religion is worthless. Religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this: to look after orphans and widows in their distress, and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. The word of God for the people of God.
Welcome to the September 18th edition of Church Family Feud. I'm your host, Steve Harvey, and it is so good to see you this morning. So, here's how we're going to do this. I have a question, and we'll see who raises their hand for answers. And the question is, 100 church saints were surveyed. And the question was, what do you make a list for? Wait, got to raise your hand. What? Shopping. Wait, hold on. Hold on. Shopping. Ding. Yes. Chores. I think that would be to-do list. No. Okay. On three. Put that back up. Ready? 1, 2, 3. All right. Santa's list. Oh, no. How did that get up? Wait. Yeah, yes. Ding. All right.
Prayer list.
I guess I shouldn't have said church saints. I should have just said 100 normal people out on the street were surveyed. Yes, church saints list, prayer list. Yeah, that would kind of go together. All right, we'll put that in at lucky number biblical 7. All right, another one.
Paying your bills.
All right, it's 2 strikes. Anybody gonna go with no? Think normal every day.
A list to not forget.
A list to not forget. I'm trying to remember what was up there. Okay, and so we can get this moving. Let's see what the top 6 were. Number 1. Okay, now you got to say it. Number 2. Number 3. Number 4. Do list. Number 5. Number 6. And number 7. Prayer list. All right, well, thank you for participating in that this morning. We love lists, don't we? Lists are something that are a part of our lives. Why do we make lists? To help us to remember, to know what to do, to organize our day, to make priorities. Because when we have a list, what are usually, you know, like 1, 2, 3, they are usually the most important. And stuff that we may not get down to on the list is usually like 29, 30, 31, even if we, you know, may have hopes of getting that far. But the ones that are lesser priority, we tend to have at the bottom of the list. The bottom of the list are things that, you know, we may get to. So you know that God really started this whole idea of top 10 lists. Book of Exodus, we have the 10 Commandments. All right, so we have these 10 Commandments. First top 10 list ever. But it wasn't enough for people because, you know, we like to understand completely what we are to do. Okay, so, okay, help me understand what all is required so I can make a list, so I can make sure I have everything checked off and I can make sure I get everything done. I want to make a list to go with the top 10 list. So I make sure I do everything. And so there are lists in the Bible. Leviticus and Deuteronomy were part of the expanding of the top 10 list into a list of what you should do. And so it became very important to the Jewish people to live according to the law, which was all to fulfill the 10 commandments. But it was, here's what you do exactly. Follow the list. God. There are lists throughout the New Testament. Paul has a list. Fruits of the Spirit. And Paul has a list of things that are not the fruits of the Spirit. In fact, things that are the opposite. Things you want to make sure you're not doing. Jesus had people come up to him and talk to him about the list. You remember the story of Jesus and the person who came up to him, the rich ruler, and said, what must I do to be saved? Follow the law. And then he says, but I've kept the Ten Commandments. I've kept all the commandments since my birth. But Jesus knew he was looking at somebody who had done a lot of the list keeping, but who had not really lived with the heart of God. And he said, go, tear up your list. Live, give of yourself. Give away what you have and live for others. And Jesus had people come up to him and say, Jesus, you see your disciples not following the Sabbath rules. They are not doing what they should do according to the list. And Jesus said, forget the list. They are doing what the Spirit of God is leading them to do by living as we really should live and not being hidebound to this list of do this, don't do that. Everything carefully controlled. Jesus tore up that list and said, what is the greatest commandment? To love God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, and to love your neighbor as yourself. You remember Jesus saying those things? So James talks about making lists. And James says, you know, lists are great, but really what's most important is that you are doing what God has asked us all to do. Next slide, please, Sonia. And when James was around, James had a lot of people following the list. And James said, you know, people who can say, I've been to church a lot. I have been on this committee. I've done this job. I've shown up for this, and I've shown up for that, and I've prayed. And James says, that's great, but what it really is all about is being a doer of the word. What you do with your life has to go with what you are saying. The talk must go with the walk. James is saying to us, to all of us, watch what you say. Because if you say you are a Christian, but your words are full of hate and negativity and tearing people down and criticizing and ridiculing, that is not God's way. The words that come out of your mouth, be slow to anger, quick to forgive. Watch your actions and make sure they do justice to what you say you believe. It isn't important to look the part and not be the part. If you're just looking like you're a Christian, that's not it. If you do all the things for the appearance of following what you think you should do, showing up for this, showing up for that, but your heart isn't really in it, then you're missing the point. James says to you and to me, you need to be who you say you are as a follower of Christ. And he says something very, very interesting. He says, now, if you really want to add things to the list, make sure that you look at the bottom of the list, because this is at the bottom of a lot of people's lists. Look out for orphans and widows and keep yourself unstained, unpolluted by the world. Now, I thought one way that you could look at that, unstained by the world, is to keep ourselves as Christians unstained by the harshness and callousness of the world. We as Christians are called to care for people. And that is really what James is saying to us. As doers of the word, that means that we are to be caring for one another. If this is the only place that we are Christians, then we have missed the point. If only on Sunday morning when we're here that we are Christians, you don't know what it is to be a follower of Jesus Christ. Doesn't matter how many times you come here, if you get out in the world and you live as if this has no meaning. That's what James is saying. And how do people know that? By how you live and how you care for people out in the world, especially the orphans and the widows, the addicted and the homeless, the people struggling on meager incomes, the dispossessed, the people struggling to make ends meet. What are we doing? How are we reaching out to them? What are you doing to be a Christian out in the world? Because those people at the bottom of the list of so many people in this world, you know, 29, 30, and 31, or 1,079, 1,080, 1,081, the people at the bottom of the list, guess whose list they're not on the bottom of? God's. You remember when Jesus, Matthew 25, says, "Blessed are you because when I was hungry, you fed me. When I was naked, you clothed me. When I was imprisoned in whatever way, you visited me and you helped me and you looked after me. I was sick and you visited me." Jesus says, when you did it to those, the least of these in the eyes of the world, you did it to me. So those people that James tells us to pay special attention to, they're at the top of God's list. Those of you who have heard me for a while now know that I love College game day on Saturdays. And when it's college football season, you know I'm going to sprinkle in some College game day illustrations. So I was watching College game day yesterday, and they were in Boone, North Carolina, the home of the Appalachian State Mountaineers. And it was the first time they'd ever been there. They had a magnificent reception. The community was absolutely stoked. And it was interesting that one of the things they brought to viewers' attention was that Boone, North Carolina, the home of Appalachian State, you know who one of the biggest advocates for Boone is and for the people of Boone? Appalachian State University. And they said that a tradition started back in the late 1980s because the staff of the football team wanted to let the community know that Appalachian State, especially their football team, was not just about the football team, but it was about the university, and that the university was a part of the community, and they were community together. A university wanting to serve the community. And so they started a tradition of Wednesday night bonfires for the community. And they held classes and conversations and kind of mini workshops, if you will, for people to work on life skills, especially for men, how to be a better father, how to live as a man who can touch the lives of the people around you. How to be a good neighbor. Because they felt it was very important to bring the community together, to educate the community, and to be educated by the community in return, because they were all in this together to take care of one another. And I thought to myself as I watched this yesterday, those are people showing what it is to be doers of the word. Those are people who are walking the talk. So, what about you and me? How are you not just a hearer of the word, but a doer of the word? Because in God's eyes, it's not at the bottom of the list. Being a doer of the word is up there at the top. My, how we have been filled today. Pancake breakfast, fellowship, caring, joy, being together, being nourished by worship, lifted by praise, and now fed at the table. To be reminded that God's grace is for us all, that God's grace goes with us into every day, and God's grace continually shapes and renews us. Today, we have been truly filled. Let us pray.
Everlasting, unchanging God, we give you thanks for every good and perfect gift from above. In today's scripture, James gives us a list to follow as Christians. Be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to anger. Humbly accept the word. Do not merely listen to the word, but do what it says. Look after orphans and widows. Keep from being polluted by the world filled with people in their rebellion against and alienation from you, Lord. Help us to follow James' list so that we can be pure and faultless in your sight. Help us too, as we come to your table, to remember and celebrate the new covenant we receive from your Son, Jesus. The bread and the cup represent his body and blood given for each of us. As we receive these symbols, fill us with your Holy Spirit and the perfect law which gives us freedom to be what we were created for. Bless us in everything we do this week. Please join me now in praying the way Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Jesus blessed the bread, and he broke it, and he gave it to them and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is for you." And he took a cup, and he poured it out, and he gave it to them and said, "Take and drink. This is the blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins." And Jesus invites us all and says, "Do this in remembrance of me." There are communion stations on either side. The bread and the cup are there individually and as one piece with loaf and cup together. However you choose to celebrate the Lord's Supper, the table is set, and may we share it together. Closing words are very simple. James reminds us, do what it says. Those are words to live by. May we go out and live out what it means to us to be a follower of Jesus. May we go out reminded the promise that God is with us always as we sing now, go now in peace. Isn't ever a joyful noise, I don't know what is. Charlotte, you are reminding us that as long as there is the laughter of a child in the world, God's love is present with us. So go now and live with that childlike faith that believes and trusts in God and touch the world around you. Amen.